Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Samantha Shokin. I'm project manager for EU-funded grants at the ESJF European Jewish Cemeteries Initiative. And it is my great pleasure to welcome you to today's virtual program, Protecting the Jewish Cemeteries of Europe, presented in partnership by the ESJF European Jewish Cemeteries Initiative, Centropa, and the Foundation for Jewish Heritage, and co-funded by the European Union. This program is the concluding event for our second EU-funded pilot project, which ran from December 2019 to July 2021, and whose aim was to map and survey a further 1,700 Jewish cemetery sites throughout Eastern and Central Europe in conjunction with a series of international education programs. The results of these programs and our extensive mapping work are available via our open access database on the project website, www.esjf-surveys.org. We will be detailing all aspects of the project with you today and have a great many esteemed speakers contributing their remarks. I would like to remind everyone that this program is being recorded and it will be available for viewing later on YouTube and Facebook. We will send out a link to that video recording to all of today's registered participants in the coming days. And now I'm very pleased to introduce our first speaker, Vice President of the European Commission, Mr. Margaritis Schinas. And although Vice President Schinas could not join us live today, he has prepared remarks in advance, which I'm very happy to share with you now. So please bear with me for just a moment while I share my screen.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is my great pleasure to be able to join you today for the closing celebration of the series of European Union pilot projects protecting the Jewish cemeteries of Europe, even if our meeting takes place by distance. Both of your projects have been extremely meaningful to the European Commission. They allow us to put back on the European map over 3,200 Jewish cemetery sites that had been forgotten and often in dire need of preservation. Your actions are of even more importance in the parts of Europe where Jewish communities are no longer present today, as the tragic aftermath of the Holocaust. Especially in those regions where there are no descendants to visit the graves of their ancestors and place a little stone there, a pebble calling the soul of the deceased the time of remembrance. Cemeteries, if we look at them through the prism of time, are in fact an expression of life. It may sound as an oxymoron, but it is true. Cemeteries are an expression of community life, of burial rites, and of coming and going from generation to generation. Mapping these cemeteries and recalling the long history of the Jewish communities living in these localities contributes to safeguarding Jewish heritage, to recalling that Jewish life has been, is, and will continue to be an essential part of what Europe stands for. Another key element of your actions is the reach to the local population, to secondary school children and teachers, to make sure the next generations will care about these cemetery sites and take ownership of them. To shape our future, we need to be able to understand our past. It is our responsibility, our duty to preserve this heritage, to pass on this history and its lessons to future generations. The European way of life is synonymous with diversity, inclusion, and peaceful coexistence. Europe is and must remain a place where religious and ethnic minorities feel free and safe to lead their lives, to practice their religious traditions and customs, to honor their ancestors, and a place where they can see a future for their children. A Europe that calls out antisemitism in all its forms and is steadfastly determined to win the fight against this centuries-old hatred. To pursue this goal, the Commission will present in autumn our first ever strategy on combating antisemitism and fostering Jewish life in the European Union. It will be an initiative that will support and complement our member states' efforts in developing their own national strategies against antisemitism. We want an ambitious and operational framework that addresses the issue comprehensively, and it does so along three main pillars: preventing and combating all forms of antisemitism, protecting and fostering Jewish life in the European Union, and finally, through education, research, and Holocaust remembrance. These actions will not be limited to our 27 member states. We will take due account of the international dimension and seek to strengthen global efforts against antisemitism. As we see antisemitism on the rise again across Europe, even more so in the context of the pandemic, it is our responsibility to stand up. We owe it to those who were murdered during the Holocaust, to those who survived it, and to the future generations. We owe it to European democracy and the peace project that the European Union represents. We want to ensure that Jewish life continues to flourish in Europe, that European Jews will continue to enrich and contribute to our future, that they will continue to be proud of being at the same time Europeans and Jewish. And we want to ensure that European Jewish history will be taught to future generations, that Jewish heritage and Jewish heritage sites will be preserved and safeguarded as part of a Europe that remembers its past and learns from it to build a better future for all. Thank you.
Thank you once again to Vice President Schinas and the European Commission for your support of the pilot project. It has been a tremendous endeavor, and we are so excited to share the results of our efforts with you today. And now I am pleased to introduce our next guest, who will speak on behalf of the ESJF European Jewish Cemeteries Initiative. Please join me in welcoming ESJF Chairman Rabbi Isaac Shapira.
Thank you. His Honorable Vice President of the European Commission, Mr. Margaritas Schinas, thank you for your very warm words, very touching and moving. Distinguished officials of the European Commission, I believe we have the honor to have at this conference our Israeli Minister for Diaspora Affairs, Mr. Nachman Shai. Dear consortium partners, my endeared friend, Mr. Philip Carmel, the CEO of the ESJF, distinguished ESJF guests, colleagues, and distinguished guests. This project, the conclusions of which are being presented today, is a jewel and perhaps the jewel within the crown of Europe, the most significant and important expression and bow to the dark past and human dignity. According to the Jewish calendar, we are presently within the 9 days, Tishat Hayamin, the peak being the ninth day in which we mourn the destruction of the two temples, the second of which was destroyed 1,956 years ago. The degree of our pain remains as such as if the destruction happened yesterday. In fact, the Jewish settlements in European countries started as a result of the destruction of the Second Temple and us being expelled from our own land. Jews always consider themselves an integral part of the country in which they settle. As history testifies, Jewish people vastly contributed to the enhancement of Europe in every respect, whether economy, culture, or social. Jews acquired with good money their dwellings as they acquired the sites for their final resting places. They never imagined that a time will come in which their resting places would be desecrated and destroyed in order to build on top of them sports halls, football grounds, shopping centers or residential towers. We as human beings of culture and morality, no matter of which race or religion, must object to the syndrome of desecrating cemeteries. Sadly, the desecration of Jewish cemeteries, which has rigorously taken place during and after the Holocaust, has still not come to an end. It is still continuing in these very days. As one who founded and chairs the ESJF, Gemeinnützige Gesellschaft zur Erhaltung und zum Schutz jüdischer Friedhöfe in Europe, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to the European Union, to our consortium partners, and to my colleagues at the ESJF, headed by my friend Philip Carmel, who embarked upon this historic and fascinating project of Europe to trace and locate the Jewish cemeteries in Eastern and Central Europe, which as a result of the Holocaust remained completely abandoned in the absence of the communities that were there to preserve the cemeteries and look after their dignity. The project is indeed a certificate of honor for Europe. The milestones achieved to date are indeed of paramount importance and significance. I would like to conclude by expressing my wish that this wonderful historic partnership should continue with the spirit of our deep commitment to jointly pursue the fulfillment and completion of our sacred mission. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rabbi Shapira. And now our next speaker, I would like to please welcome our, speaking on behalf of our consortium partner, Centropa founding director, Mr. Edward Sirota. Edward, are you with us?
I am. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for having me. I'll keep my remarks fairly short because you're going to hear from my colleague, Fabian Rula. But I'd like to paint a picture of what Centropa has done over the past few years. We began life as a Jewish Historical Institute, an oral history institute in 2000, and we spent a decade interviewing elderly Jews still living in 19 countries in Central and Eastern Europe. We wanted to talk with them not so much about how their families perished only during the Holocaust, but how their families lived before and during and after. We never used video. I come from a television background and I also worked in print. I always liked the way that you could interview with in print more than video, because when you made mistakes, you could go back and fix it. So our idea was to scan family pictures. And I spent years between 1985 and 2000, 15 years visiting people in their apartments and homes in Zagreb and in Košice and all of these cities where they would share their pictures and tell me stories about the people in the pictures. And that's what Centropa did. We digitized over 25,000 pictures. We have 45,000 pages of stories, personal stories. It was only natural that we would go into education, and we went into education to tell those stories and share them with teachers. Being open source, we asked teachers to tell us what they need. We have a whole network of European Jewish schools, which we feel is vitally important, but also we work with public schools. And most importantly, it's important to take teenagers today and turn them into stakeholders in the lands where the Holocaust took place. I think that should be self-evident to everyone. To make teenagers in towns in Ukraine, Moldova, and in Croatia, Bosnia, Greece, and all of the countries where Fabian's team, my colleague's team, worked with the ESGF team, what we realized and what was so exciting was that that cemeteries are actually great places for teenagers to explore and teachers to use as a way of learning and a way of learning about the Jewish history of their town. It actually shocked me. I had no idea that the students and teachers would enjoy this so much and learn from it. Now that's what you'll hear from Fabian. I've said enough, and I want to thank you again for inviting me.
Thank you so much, Ed. And now, speaking on behalf of our third consortium partner, please welcome Foundation for Jewish Heritage trustee, Dame Helen Hyde.
Thank you so much for sharing this, and the Vice President spoke really emotionally. I feel very honored that we are part of this wonderful partnership and wonderful work in Europe. Our foundation has done very similar work. We've mapped many, many synagogues with the help of Yad Vashem. And an interesting statistic is 3,318 historic synagogues exist today, and most of them are not in good order and need restoring, and we're working there. And as you all know, synagogues and cemeteries were very, very closely associated. And as we know as well, if we don't know our history, we can't really plan for our future, nor can we build good educational programs. So I believe our whole consortium shares a mission to preserve the memory, to map synagogues, to map cemeteries, to preserve memory of all that's lost, to find the traces of the once vibrant Jewish communities, and to try to fill that awful void that exists in so many places through education. I know that through our joint work, our educational programs, we'll ensure that future generations, young and old, will know the history of their community, what was there, who lived there, what they contributed, and together we can restore these important traces of history and restore dignity to those that are no longer there, and to educate those communities where there are no Jews left, and even if there are a few Jews. But I think our educational programs, and for me, seeing what Centropa did when we were together in Hungary, was a marvelous experience, and I look very much forward to us all working together to create a better educational program and to educate. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dame Helen. And now to present an overview of the grant, please welcome Mr. Philip Carmel, Chief Executive Officer of the ESJF.
Thank you, Samantha, for organizing this event. Thank you for your introduction. Thank you to all our consortium partners. Thank you, Rabbi Shapiro, for your very inspiring words, and to Dame Helen, and to Ed as well, for all that you've done for this project's success. Thank you also to Vice President Shinas for some really, truly inspiring words, which I think shows the commitment of the European Union, both to this project specifically and to combating anti-Semitism and preserving the Jewish life in Europe. I also want to thank all at DG Culture and Education, including Commissioner Gabriel, and particularly to the officers who worked on our project, including Masiage. The nascence of this project actually began in about 2016. It was a time when we as an organization approached both Martin Schulz, who was then president of the European Parliament, and also a president Barroso of the Commission. And we discussed how we could, in a macro sense, talk about how to protect and to preserve Jewish sites, but also to raise awareness and local involvement and engagement from local communities and from mayors and from local authorities and from school children included, to take this on into future generations. Because the fact is that after 80 years following the Shoah, in most of these communities, in most of these towns and villages, there are no longer Jews there. And the real reason why these cemeteries are not protected, they are neglected, they are sometimes vandalized, they are destroyed, they are destroyed on a daily basis. The reason for that is that there are no Jews there. And the reason that there are no Jews there is that the Jews were killed on the basis of intolerance and hate. And that education process into bringing people from different cultures and different environments together is what this project is about. It's also about getting this information down before it goes. We have found cemeteries that did not exist on previous lists. And we have got those down now onto a database which is available online to all people whenever they need it. That is the first stage of protection. I want to thank as well, in particular, two people who were really involved from the start of this project. One of them, because of the work we did with the European Parliament, was Charles Goerens, MEP, a Luxembourgeois MP, who we met on a number of occasions and really pushed this project forward through the European Parliament and ultimately to be accepted by the European Commission. I also want to thank Katharina von Schnorbein, who is here now in a different role in her role in the combating anti-Semitism, a role that she has incredibly led and showed amazing initiative in bringing this up as a major part of the EU debate, who at that time worked with the President Barroso and also enabled us to push this project forward. This has been a vast enterprise. We began it in the first year of the project with 1,500 sites surveyed, and we've continued it now with another 1,700 surveyed. A lot of that information, as I say, is down here for the first time. It is the first stage in the protection process, but it is by no means the last. We need to continue with this project. I know the European Union has launched a third year of preparatory action, and that needs to continue. Local engagement needs to continue. Local protection projects also need to continue. I would say also that the constant is that we need to continue this process of surveying and of education. The work the Centropa have done in bringing this into the classroom and bringing students outside of the classroom to actively take part in protection work has been crucial. I want to talk a little bit about how the project has panned out. We started in a very different time. We started before COVID. We couldn't have possibly imagined that there would be restrictions on cross-country travel, in finding accommodation, in getting material together. I should tell you, because this gives you some indication of the new world that we are in, I've never actually met Samantha, who is our project manager. That's the new COVID reality. I know many people have suffered. I know many people have had a lot of trouble with COVID. We've had to adapt to a very different reality. And the fact that we have achieved this with the support of the European Commission, with the support of all our consortium partners, is down to the tremendous dedication of all the people involved in this project. I want to publicly thank them. I want to publicly thank the European Commission for this fantastic initiative. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much, Phil. And now I'd like to please welcome our Director of Historical Research at ESJF, Dr. Katharina Malachova, who is going to present an overview of our survey results. Katya, are you with us?
Of course. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, dear colleagues, now let me show you the results of cemetery surveys made during 2021. Just a moment. I'll share my screen. So our survey results. Here are the numbers which we planned to survey during this project. We decided to take some specific countries and regions, which are 9 regions in Ukraine, all country in Georgia, 2 counties on the north of Hungary, northern regions around the half of the territory of the country in Lithuania, all country in Croatia, 4 regions in Slovakia, and 8 voivodeships in Poland. And the total number of planned surveys was 1713. For today, we have surveyed 1763 Jewish cemeteries. the amount of processed cemeteries, processed questionnaires for today is 1455. Each questionnaire, each information get from the field is being edited several times. So now around 1400 are processed and the process continues. How do we get these numbers? The cemetery lists, which we are working with. Our methodology is to check and to compile the most full list from the main existing databases, which are different for each country. Then to pick the sites with a considerable Jewish population, which could have the cemetery, to add the information from the historical maps where the Jewish cemeteries could be depicted from other sources. And so we have checked, we have visited lots of the sites, which numbers you can see on the screen. And finally, we have 344 Jewish cemeteries for Ukraine. And I want to stress that 100 of them are not mentioned in any existing database, which we used three main existing databases on Jewish cemeteries on Ukraine. 100 was not mentioned there. For Georgia, no list existed. We have 31 surveyed cemetery, and we believe that that's not all, but it requires more research to find the others. For Hungary, it was planned to visit 300 cemeteries. The existing database mentions 304 Jewish cemeteries in the regions which we plan to work. We checked 341 sites, and finally we have surveyed 320 Jewish cemeteries there. And from them, 25 Jewish cemeteries were not mentioned in the list. They were found either by checking with cadastral maps or by checking the local situation, speaking with the people on the sites. 25 sites were not included in the previous databases. In Lithuania, the situation is different because Lithuania is well studied, and we had two very authoritative and two very good databases which we used, which had around 200 Jewish cemeteries each. But when we compiled them, we discovered that some of them were mentioned in one but database, but not another. So finally, we have the list of 213 Jewish cemeteries for all country. And three of the found cemeteries were not mentioned there. For Croatia, we worked with two cemetery lists compiled by Professor Ivan Cherešnjev and by Dr. Jan Matic, who is today with us. Hi, Jan. So here the situation is different because these databases did not contain the information about exact location of the cemetery. So we managed to locate 76 Jewish cemeteries, and we hope that in future it will be possible to find more. For Slovakia, we have surveyed 234 Jewish cemeteries, and around 16 of them were not mentioned in databases. I would like to stress that the main and the most authoritative list of Jewish cemeteries in Slovakia is a community restitution list, which was considered to be the most full one, but in fact it appeared that around 100 Jewish cemeteries were not mentioned there. In Poland, we have surveyed 657 Jewish cemeteries, and three were not mentioned in any databases. So together with the results of the surveys in previous year, which was done in 2019-2020, it makes 3,110 Jewish cemeteries surveyed during last 2 years, which means that Ukraine is fully surveyed, Georgia fully surveyed, Moldova also, Lithuania also, as well as Croatia and Greece, and partly Slovakia, Hungary, and Poland. Now, general results for the surveys of that year. 485 Jewish cemeteries, 33%, were categorized as fenced and protected. 29% were categorized as unfenced Jewish cemeteries, which require the most urgent protection. Around 100 Jewish cemeteries, 7%, are Jewish sections in municipal cemeteries, which are protected as a part of municipal cemetery. 15% are demolished sites that have not been overbuilt, and 40% demolished and overbuilt and lost for us, unfortunately. Now speaking about physical condition of these cemeteries, 1,026 Jewish cemeteries have at least one tombstone preserved, which is 70%. But I'd like to stress that it does not mean that these cemeteries are well preserved, and even we can call it preserved. More than 200 cemeteries have less than 10 tombstones preserved, which means that they are majorly ruined. And only around 350 have been preserved more or less in the pre-war condition. And this amount is very approximate because not in all cases we know which was a pre-war condition and if some tombstones were ruined or not. And 29% are demolished, among them 225 non-overbuilt, which means that the burials could have preserved. And it is very important for determining the site as a Jewish cemetery. It's very important from the halachic point of view. And 204 are unfortunately overbuilt. Let's take a picture of distribution of these figures by countries. The country with the worst situation with preservation of Jewish cemeteries appeared to be Greece, surveyed last during the previous stage of the project, with only 48% of cemeteries with at least one tombstone. And the best rate, as we can see, are Georgia and Slovakia, and after that, Hungary and Lithuania, where lots of Jewish cemeteries have been preserved with at least one tombstone, which does not mean that they are preserved in the pre-war condition. In all that countries, they are majorly ruined. And how we can explain this difference in that figures, let's take a look on more detailed map. So you can see that in Slovakia, in northern part of Hungary and in the Carpathia, the rates of the percentage of Jewish cemeteries with at least one tombstone preserved are very high, at the level of 19%, 80%. This can be explained by the history during the Holocaust and after that in these regions, in areas with a Hungarian influence. Jews were killed during the Holocaust very late, and the Jewish cemeteries were not destroyed during the war. And also after that, the Jewish cemeteries were not majorly destroyed in post-war time, as it was in Ukraine and Lithuania, where in Poland, where the Soviet regime had a specific policy of destroying Jewish cemeteries and killing the memory. So speaking about protection, 591 cemetery is discovered to be protected, which makes 40% of the cemeteries described. Among them are fenced and protected Jewish cemeteries and also Jewish sections protected as a part of municipal cemetery. 45%, 660 Jewish cemeteries require urgent protection, which include 435 unfenced Jewish cemeteries with at least one tombstone preserved, and 225 demolished cemeteries that has not been built over, which means that there is a chance that the burial preserved. And 14%, 204 cemeteries are overbuilt. The distribution by countries is more or less coincide with the situation with the preservation of the cemeteries. The best rate of protection of Jewish cemeteries we can see in Slovakia, in Hungary, in the Carpathia, and in southern regions of Poland. While in Ukraine, the situation is the worst, the average level of unprotected Jewish cemeteries is very, very high, but the situation is not much better in Croatia and Lithuania, where lots of cemeteries remain unfenced and still are in danger. Now, if now after that, after we have the checked amounts of Jewish cemeteries for each region and each country surveyed, we can make some conclusions about, we can get some full picture about density of Jewish cemeteries. So here you can see the distribution, territorial distribution of Jewish cemeteries. Jewish cemeteries per 10,000 square kilometers, which also shows us an interesting situation that the highest density of Jewish cemeteries we can see in Slovakia, in Zakarpattia, and in northern parts of Hungary. And it can be explained that these territories are part of the former Kingdom of Hungary as a part of Austro-Hungarian Empire, and the territories under Hungarian influence. And the it reflects the way of Jewish settlements. These are territories where the Jewish settlements were mostly rural, and a very small communities with some dozen Jews got a permission to have their own cemetery. So literally there is a cemetery in each village on your way. And if we check this with the dates of the oldest tombstones in these regions, we can see that most part of the cemeteries are emerged in 19th century. So the situation, this distribution of territorial distribution reflects the situation of 19th century. There are much more conclusions which can be made by our statistics, and the work on analysis on the situation by country is being made now, and it will be preserved in our final report. Now, the last, how many cemeteries still require fencing, still require surveys in Central and Eastern Europe? We have large plans. There are more than 3,000 cemeteries in Central and Eastern Europe which still require surveys. And we hope that we will continue our work and we will get the exact numbers of Jewish cemeteries, and we will have the situation with the protection of Jewish cemeteries and situation about its preservation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Katya, for that fascinating presentation. I would like to once again remind our audience if anyone is interested in reading more about our surveys in detail, please visit our project website, www.esjf-surveys.org. And now I'm very pleased to welcome our next speaker, who also is contributing some pre-recorded remarks, Dr. Nachman Shai, who's Israeli Minister of Diaspora Affairs. So please bear with me for just a moment as I share my screen once again.
Shalom and good evening to you all. Our collective ability to honor the past is central to building a more understanding future. In this spirit, it is my pleasure to join all of you for the ESJF event on protecting Jewish cemeteries in Europe. As the Minister of Diaspora Affairs, I appreciate and thank you for this work. I see myself as your partner in this important task. All of us have a role to play in preserving Jewish history and educating our rising generation on the Jewish people's legacy in Europe and around the world. I personally understand the power of protecting and preserving Jewish cemeteries. Let me tell you something personal. On a trip to Wrocław, Poland, with my Poland chief rabbi, I visited a mixed Christian Jewish cemetery with a small corner for the once prominent Jewish community. There, I saw my mother's maiden name, Zichlinski, on a gravestone. There, I discovered my grandfather's final resting place. This powerful moment articulated for me the living importance of preserving and honoring these sites for my children and yours. Thank you to USJF for turning these spaces not only into historical landmarks, but educational tools for schools, universities, and communities, both local and global. We, the State of Israel, see ourselves as your partners in this work to preserve the Jewish people's legacy and future. I would like again, particularly like to thank you, Vice President Margaritis Shines, Commissioner Maya Gabriel, and the Director General for Education and Cultural for spearheading this work. I would also like to thank Member of Parliament Charles Gornas and Rabbi Isaac Shapira for their continuing leadership and vision. I wish you all success and look forward to deepening our partnership in the future. Thank you and toda rabba.
Thank you, Minister Shive. And our next speaker also contributing pre-recorded remarks. I'm pleased to welcome Charles Gorens, MEP, who is integral in helping to apply and get the grant for us. And unfortunately, due to some technical issues, the video recording that we received, I think gets cut off a little bit at the very end, but nevertheless, I'm going to play it for you now. So thank you. And apologies for the inconvenience, just a moment.
A few years ago, me and other members of the European Parliament took the initiative to start a pilot project in the framework of the EU budget. Our approach was to allow financial resources to be used for the rehabilitation of Jewish cemeteries in the eastern part of Europe. My personal appreciation is the following. Jewish communities in these countries that are often unable to finance such projects should not be forgotten, and we should build bridges from the past in the future. The project not only consists of constructing concrete walls, but it also serves educational purposes. This means that 80 years after the Holocaust, it is important to remember that in the beginning of the 20th century, the Jewish community was at the origin of a progressive economic and cultural society. With this project, we remember a civilization that Nazis wanted to be eradicated and which we now want to bring back to consciousness. In this context, it is an interesting project for historians as well as for schools and the public opinion in general.
Thank you again, Mr. Gorens. And now for our next speaker joining us live, I'm very pleased to welcome Mr. Fabian Rulle, who is director of Centropa Germany. Fabian will be presenting an educational project overview from our pilot project. So Fabian, are you with us?
Yes, I am. Thank you, Samantha. Can you hear me? Yes, perfect. I want to thank all the previous speakers for their words and for especially to Phil Kamel for giving such kind words also to this consortium. It has been a pleasure working with the ESJF and with the Foundation for Jewish Heritage, which is today represented by Dame Helen Hyde, but also by Michael Mayle. It has been a pleasure working with all of you. And I want to thank, of course, all the my colleagues who are listening today, but not presenting. When we met, and I think it was February 2020, we met in Budapest, and I remember one of our colleagues saying, "Well, let's see, there's this virus going on, and how it's going to affect us." And I was waving it off, and saying, "Well, we can run our seminars, and well, I don't have to tell you how difficult it has been for all of us in the past 18 months or so." Nevertheless, I'm particularly proud to say that with the help of the European Commission and with our consortium partners, we were able to conduct all the 7 seminars which we had planned to do. 5 of them we were able to do in person. The one in Georgia and in Ukraine we had to do in November and December in online, but we managed to attract more than 240 teachers from these seven countries, Georgia, Ukraine, Lithuania, Slovenia, Croatia, Poland, and Hungary. And together with our colleagues from the Centropa Budapest office, we adapted, let's say, the successful Centropa education program that Ed briefly mentioned of recruiting teachers and asking them to tell to learn this and to learn more about Centropa materials and to tell stories, to ask the students to research local history and to research personal stories. We adapted that model, particularly for this ESJF led consortium, project consortium. So we ran a series of seminars where teachers were, they learned from international experts about the epitaphs on cemeteries. They learned about the Jewish history of each country. But most importantly, like Phil said, we asked the teachers to join us as long as it was possible to walk outside and meet and gather in groups. We asked them to visit local Jewish cemeteries in a group, because a lot of these teachers, let's face it, they have never been to a cemetery. Like Ed said, Centropa was also new to the cemetery part. So for us, it also came as a positive surprise that teachers were so enthusiastic about learning about Jewish cemeteries and including them, incorporating them in their classroom teaching, especially in this pandemic driven year where a lot of teachers were forced to teach online. They still managed to incorporate Jewish cemeteries in the classroom. So I just want to share one photograph with you before I'm going to show a student project afterwards. But I just want to show this photo because it really epitomizes the way we adapted our programs last year. This is, you see here, Bartek Fenzel at the Krakow's new Jewish cemetery, which very sadly has been hit by a thunderstorm. I believe it was yesterday or 2 days ago and severely damaged. But we took a group of 30 plus teachers from all over Poland to the cemetery. Like I said, many of them went to the cemetery for the very first time. They learned about the tombstones, they learned about epitaphs, and then they worked in groups to research and brainstorm how they can turn this into classroom material. Stop sharing my screen. As a second step then, we launched a competition in all the seven countries. And this competition was meant for students on the one hand, and then also for teachers. Teachers were encouraged to submit lesson plans, and we had a total of 95 teachers submitting lesson plans from seven countries. And we can find, I'm putting the chat in the chat, I'm putting the link where you can find the best lessons. On the very bottom of this page, you can find lessons broken down by country. What I want to finish my very short presentation on is what's very important to Centropa is we want to engage the future stakeholders, the future generation of European citizens. So that's why we really want, that's why we were so pleased to have a group of 97 students participating, or 97 schools, let me correct this, from seven countries in our seven country competition on My Town Jewish Cemetery. We launched this competition really at the height of COVID-19. And what we did is, I'm gonna share again my screen. So here you see, we sent out these guidelines in each of the seven country languages, of course. And this again was an adaptation of previously successful Centropa competitions where we had previously focused on using Centropa materials. Here it was really about focusing on how to use a Jewish cemetery, how students can explore this. So we asked students to either create a short film, no longer than 7 minutes. Most students like didn't make that cut. You will see that the best film was 7 minutes 50, but still we had a range of fantastic films from all these seven countries. Then we asked students to create online brochures, which they could then theoretically use as advertisement for let's say the local tourism board. And finally, we had also had a category where students were encouraged to create an own website in English and in their local language, as thereby improving their English, improving their digital skills, and of course, learning about Jewish cemeteries. So thanks to the coordinators in each country, and this is something I didn't mention earlier, all our work would have not been possible without the coordinators in Croatia, in Poland, et cetera, especially in Poland. For instance, we worked with the Galicia Jewish Museum, which organized the seminar on the ground and which helped us coordinate this competition. So thanks to the work of the coordinators and our partners on the ground, we managed to get, as I said, 97 projects from seven countries. And I'm going to show you now as an example, the winner from Lithuania, which was, the film was done by students in the city of Kaunas. Oops, excuse me. Here we go.
Kiekviena bendruomenė turi savo įsitikinimus, papročius, religiją ir kapinis. Tai neatsiejama žmogaus gyvenimo dalis. Žydų bendruomenė Kaune – neišimtis. Kaune išlikusi pagal paskirtį naudojama tik viena sinagoga. Taip pat Kaune yra trys žydų kapinis, vienintelės veikiančios Aleksoto ir dvi nebeveikiančios Vilijampolės ir Žaliakalnio.
Aleksoto žydų kapinės užima pailgą žemės plotą prie Aleksoto kalno šlaito už seno pramoninio geležinkelio. Dar 19 amžiuje įkurtose kapinėse vėl aktyviai pradėta laidoti apie 1950 metus, kai kitas Kaune veikusias kapinės uždarė arba sunaikino. Užeikime ir apsižvalgykime. Esame seniausiose žydų kapinėse Kaune. Jos buvo įkurtos 18 amžiaus pradžioje Vilijampolės miestelio pakraštyje, kuris tik 1919 metais tapo Kauno miesto dalimi. Kadangi žydų bendruomenė buvo išvaryta iš Kauno centro, Vilijampolė tapo jų gyvenimo dalimi, todėl čia buvo įkurtos naujos kapinės. 1963 metais sovietų valdžia kapinės uždarė ir šią teritoriją suorė, bet ant kalnelio tarp medžių išliko nemažai senų ankapių. 19 amžiuje Kauno mieste gyvenę žydai vis dar buvo laidojami Vilijampolės kapinėse. Mirusiųjų kūnai buvo perkeliami valtimis ar keltais per Neries upę. Kelis kartus dėl potvynio nepavykus nuplukdyti mirusiųjų į Vilijampolės kapinės, tai tapo priežastimi 1861 metais atsidaryti Žaliakalnio žydų kapinėms. Jos plėtėsi ir tapo didžiausia pagal plotą žydų laidojimo vieta Kaune. Žydų kapinės skiriasi nuo kitų religijų kapinių. Ant kapų nedamos gėlės, betoniniai antkapiai be paminklų. Kapinės turi būti aptvertos tvora, kad atskirtų gyvųjų ir mirusiųjų pasaulius. Dabar mes esame Žaliakalnio kapinėse. Čia yra palaidota gan daug ne tik Lietuvoje buvusių žymių žydų. 1952 metais Žaliakalnio žydų kapinės buvo uždarytos ir paliktos likimo valiai, niokojamos, ir tik nuo 1998 buvo įtrauktos Lietuvos Respublikos nekilnojamų kultūros vertybių registrą.
Pevičių kapinių atskirais kultūros paveldo objektais paskelbti Danielius Dolskio ir dailininko Jokūbo Mezenbliumo paminklai. Keliaukim Laisvės alėją ir sužinosim apie jos daugiau.
Susipažinkite. Danielius Dolskis. Jis gimė Vilniuje, nežinia kada, bet perskėlė į Sankt Peterburgą, ten mokėsi ir pradėjo savo senos karjerą kaip kupletininkas. Kupletininkų programą dažniausiai sudarydavo komiški pasakojimai, lengva turinio dainelės, žmonių parodijavimas. Dolskis per savo karjerą aplankė nemažai miestų ir šalių, tačiau galiausiai atvyko ir apsistojo Kaune. Kodėl? Na, yra sakoma, kad atvykti į Kauną Dolskį paskatino susitikimas tuo metu Berlyne studijavusių kauniečių smuikininkų, tačiau mes įžvelgėme kitą priežastį. Danielius dažniausiai koncertuodavo bendruomenėms, kurios buvo kupinos panašaus ar aukštesnio lygio talentų. Atsirado senos konkurencija. Dolskis į Kauną atvyko 1929 metais ir, pamatęs, kad čia nėra tokios konkurencijos, pasiliko visam laikui. Visi mėgo Dolskį. Kaunas klausė jo pasirodymų tik rusiškai ir staiga visiškai netikėtai savo repertuarą atnaujino ir sulietuvino, įtraukė naujų kūrinių ir jiems parašė lietuviškus tekstus. Dolskis buvo pirmasis to žanro artistas, pasiryžęs pramokti lietuviškai, ką padarė vos per pusmetį. Jis buvo lietuviškos estrados pradininkas, o jo dainos tapo klasika.
Gražas kojas, kam turys, ar tau daug naudos, iš ilgos naujos tuknios, kojų tavo išties.
Deja, viskas pasibaigė taip pat greitai ir netikėtai, kaip ir prasidėjo. Danielius Dolskis mirė Kaune 1931 metų gruodžio 3 dieną. Po pasirodymo čia anksčiau buvusiame Versalio restorane, jis sušilęs išgėrė šalto alaus ir susirgo plaučių uždegimu. Mirė staiga, sirgęs vos keletą dienų. Belieka tik džiaugtis, kad tie du Danieliaus Dolskio praleisti metai Kaune padarė nemažą postumį Kauno pramoginiam gyvenimui.
Žodžio palatės dar vienas žydas susitikęs su Lietuvos kultūra tarpukariu. Tai Jokūbas Mezenblumas, tapytojas, grafikas, pirmasis žydų dailininkas, aktyviai reiškysis nepriklausomai Lietuvoje. Gyvas dailininkas nebuvo labai garsus, jei minimas, dažniausiai peikiamas, pardas menkai lankomas. Kaune nesulaukęs pripažinimo jis išvyko į Paryžių. 1932 metais, sunkiai sirgdamas, grįžo į Kauną, kur netrukus ir mirė. Pamirties dailininkas tapo labai populiarus Lietuvoje. Jis mums svarbus kaip pedagogas, dėstys piešimą vienoje iš žydų gimnazijų veikusių tuo metu. Nors Mezenblumui neteko patirti didelio pasisekimo, vienam iš auklėtinių taip puikiai pavyko. Emis Arbit Blatas, pasaulinį pripažinimą pelnės ir išskirtinio talento litvakas dailininkas. Gimė ir kurį laiką gyveno Kaune. Dėl karo su šeima pabėgo į Ukrainą. Nemis nuo pat vaikystės domėjosi piešimu. Krizių po karo čia anksčiau buvusioje žydų mokykloje, Mezenblumo paskatintas tęsė meno mokslus. Tarėmas išvyko į užsienį toliau mokytis, kur buvo pripažintas puikiu dailininku. Susipažino su Pablo Picasso bei daug kartus vedė. Tačiau Blatas niekada nepamiršo ir Lietuvos. Grįždavo aplankyti tėvų ir netyrengė pirmąją Baltijos šalyse nuosavą meno galeriją. Laisvalaikiu tapė žmonės kavinėse arba peizažus iš natūros. Tėvų mirtis Blatą paskatino sukurti bareljefų monumentus, holokausto aukoms atminti. Pats dailininkas mirė 1999 metais. Daug Arbit Blato kūrinių saugomi didžiuosiuose pasaulio muziejuose, kai kurie darbai taip pat saugomi ir Lietuvoje.
Kaune žydų bendruomenė gyvojo maždaug nuo 14 amžiaus pabaigos, todėl savaime aišku, kad čia gimė arba gyveno daug įvairiose srityse pasižymėjusių žydų. Jie prisidėjo ne tik prie Kauno kultūros pramoginėje industrijoje, bet ir kitose šakose.
Pavyzdžiui, Abraomas Mapu, rašytojas, pripažintas pirmoji romanų kūrėjų hebrajų kalba. Daugiausiai populiarumo susilaukė romanas Meilės Jonė. Abraomas mėgo rašyti aleksotę. Savo romanus kūrė pavėsinėje ant aleksoto kalvos.
Kitas puikus pavyzdys – žymėjai broliai Minkovskiai, du labai talentingi ir daug pasižymėję žydai, gimė Kaune ir mokėsi Maironio gimnazijoje. Hermanas Minkovskis – talentingas matematikas, fizikas, mokęs Albertą Einšteiną ir padėjęs pagrindus relativumo teorijai. Oskaras Minkovskis – talentingas patofiziologas ir terapeutas, prisidėjęs prie insulino išradimo. Tai jam žmonės turėtų būti dėkingi, kad cukrinis diabetas nebėra mirtina liga.
Visuomenė – tai stebuklas, kai žmogus išeina iš savo ribų. Tai viena iš Emanuelio Levino citatų. Emanuelis, buvęs žydų filosofas, gimęs ir vaikystę praleidęs Kaune. Žinomas dėl savo darbo susijusi su žydų filosofija, egzistencializmu, etika, fenomenologija ir ontologija. Ant sienos tamo, kuris gyveno, yra dvi atminimo lentelės – lietuviškai ir prancūziškai.
Už kai kuriuos dar ir dabar svarbius pastatus Kauno mieste turime būti dėkingi Anatolijui Rozenblumui, inžinieriui ir projektuotojui prisidėjusiems prie Kauno centrinio pašto karininkų romovės KTU chemijos fakulteto konstrukcijų projektavimo. Rozenblumas taip pat buvo atsakingas ir už Kauno sporto halės konstrukcijas, kurias suprojektavo likus tik pusmečiui iki Europos krepšinio čempionato, kai kiti inžinieriai tam nesiryžo. Pastatas buvo pripažintas tuo metu architektūrinių šedevrų.
Į šią vienintelę veikiančią choralinę sinagogą Kaune gyvenantys žydai renkasi melstis, nors jų po antrojo pasaulinio karo liko tik mažuma. Žydų tauta labai prisidėjo prie Kauno kultūrinio gyvenimo visose srityse. Lieka tik džiaugtis tuo ir tikėtis, kad mūsų tautos ir ateityje viena kita papildys ir puoselės kultūrinį paveldą. O dabar deja jau atsisveikiname.
So, I would like to tip of the head, the virtual head to all the students, not the, only the students from Kaunas, but all the students who participate and their teachers who made this happen, because after at the end of the day, is the teachers who made these wonderful projects happen. And keep in mind, this was done during this particular difficult year, especially for students, high school students across Europe, around the world. And we had an event with 150 students and teachers just a couple of weeks ago, where these films, the winning films were presented, and each of the winners got a sort of little prize for their school in cinema tickets, hoping that the cinemas are still are opening again. And we really hope that in the coming year, we can finally meet in person again with the teachers, with the students. And I want to thank again everyone for listening, and our partners, of course, for allowing Centropa to be in this wonderful project. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Fabian. The video was lovely. We had some issues reading the captions. I think it might be just a connectivity problem. So fear not, that video and many others from the competition are available on YouTube, as well as not only the videos, but there were website entries, brochures, and the list of all student entries and all the winners, like Fabian mentioned, is available on our project website. I believe he put a link into the chat, and all of our teacher lesson plans too, in all of the languages of our project countries. And now moving on to our next speaker, who also contributed some pre-recorded remarks. I'm pleased to welcome Ms. Katharina von Schnurbein, who is coordinator on combating anti-Semitism at the European Commission. So just one moment.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is my pleasure to join you for this closing program of the European Jewish Cemeteries Initiative, even if only by video message. I want to congratulate you and to thank you for all the efforts and energy you have placed in this project. I followed your work for several years now. In fact, I vividly remember a meeting with Yossi Beilin and Philip Carmel in 2014, when I was advisor for the dialogue with religions with then EU Commission President Barroso. It is amazing how much you have achieved since then. Your work has been a battle against ignorance, a battle against anti-Semitism, a battle for restoring historical truth, for putting a name, for putting back on the map forgotten Jewish communities. Your work has served to identify, to map, to highlight, to fence over 3,000 neglected and threatened Jewish cemetery sites. You honored and paid tribute to the millions of East Central European Jews for whom no survivor or descendant will ever come to commemorate their soul. This last year has been difficult. You succeeded to overcome the challenges posed by the COVID-19 pandemic and the travel restrictions that followed. You had to adapt and change your initial plans, notably regarding teaching seminars because of the lockdown in various countries that you covered. You managed, though, to continue to engage with local communities, with religious communities, education ministries, civil society, as well as, where possible, also the local Jewish communities. Since the start of the pandemic, we saw a rise of conspiracy myths and disinformation, including a rise of anti-Semitic hate speech. If physical anti-Semitic incidents in the public sphere have slightly diminished, the desecration of Jewish cemeteries have been on the rise, as cemeteries are one of the few places that are not guarded or secured in the Jewish community. Vice President Margarete Skinners, responsible for promoting the European way of life, was clear when he said recently that fighting, preventing, and eradicating anti-Semitism is up to all of us. It is in this spirit that this October, the European Commission will present its first ever European strategy on combating anti-Semitism and fostering Jewish life. Safeguarding Jewish heritage will be one of the priorities of this upcoming strategy, as we aim to talk about Jewish life, culture, and history as a prerequisite to understanding the impact of the Holocaust and what it meant for local community life. Another important aspect of the strategy will be to address antisemitism online. As we enter a new digital era, we see how the internet plays a major role in all aspects of our daily lives. In this respect, I wanted to highlight your efforts in putting together an impressive database and state-of-the-art 3D models of non-demolished cemeteries. Such a database, as well as your new website, will probably be useful for a large network of experts in cultural heritage, for historians and art historians, for teachers, as well as for professionals from the tourism sector. Indeed, the condition and status of Jewish cemeteries largely differs according to the country you surveyed. Having Jewish cemeteries protected in every European and non-European state as an integral part of the historical monuments, as is the case in Greece, is certainly a best practice. The importance of reaching out to local communities, to grassroots organizations and people that will continue and strengthen the work you have started cannot be overestimated. Knowing about one's local history is central for an inclusive society. In that way, your work will contribute to building a stronger society, a Europe where everyone can live freely. It is only by understanding our past that we will be able to build our future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Katerina, for your very important words. Now, I am pleased to welcome our next speaker, who is actually joining us live from Kiev. Please welcome Mr. Alexander Besarov, Technical Manager at the ESJF, for a presentation of the project website. Alex?
Thank you, Samantha. I would like to share a screen and display our project website, and I will start with some technical details. At the initial stage, we collected technical requirements for the project and conducted audit of existing resources, in particular the files and the website. Further research carried out for a possible technical solution with the help of which it would be possible to implement the displaying of the models in the web browser. During the process, an important criteria was an availability of an open source software. As a result of this preliminary stage, several options were found that met the specified criteria. Before making a decision, several tests were performed with the existing model files. In course of this test, it turned out that some of the LAS extension files do not meet the necessary format criteria that would be supported by the found models. It was decided to convert the source of files to a different coordinate system that allowed them to display on the project website. The decision was made to focus on a model that allows user to display the content of model not only on the numerous website, only numerous browsers, but also enable them to display 3D models on the mobile devices. At the same time, chosen solution did not require additional efforts with existing files. One more advantage of this solution was the quality of displaying 3D models in high resolution compared to others. The solution itself allowed uploading the models directly into the user's browser and saving server resources. The last step of the development was the optimization of the models in the LAZ format, which reduced the size of the files and made the uploading of the models even faster compared to the previous format. Integration with the project website was carried out with application of a native technology. During development process, the team was guided by the principles of non-interference with the existing architecture of the website. Therefore, a separate web page was created for the model rendering performance, to which a link from the existing site would guide. It was decided to leave toggle elements that would allow users to control the model and also rotate it in orbital directions. The model was reloaded in the case when a user changed the quality or other optional features that are located in the menu. The final stage of the solution was integration of the existing models to the project website. Since by the time of integration, not all models had been converted into required format, there was a need of automatic solution that would allow adding more models to appear on the project website without attracting any additional resources of developers. A service console application was created and moved that will move models to the required hosting service and also upload the site database so that the site displayed links lead to a model page. While transferring files, it was decided to store files on a cloud server, since the storage of the files on the rented hosting required additional financial resources. In conclusion, we created additional web resources for displaying 3D models and optimized conversion of existing LAS files and developed a console service for an integration to the project website and optimized hosting cost. So, well, you can see the project website, and I will show you how the search feature is working on our project website. So if you will hop into the survey page, the tab, you will be able to see the map, yeah, because most of our data it was easily to display using the map. So on the right side, you have a bar chart that is indicating the degree of preservation of the cemeteries. If you want to search a specific cemetery, there is a couple of options which are available. First is, well, if you will click on the search page, then you will be able to search cemetery by name. For instance, you can type in Chudniv. Well, this is a cemetery in Ukraine, and you will be, it's going to indicate that it's located in Ukraine and that it's in Zhytomyr Oblast. For instance, if you don't know the name of the cemetery, yeah? So there is also an option of finding it by country. So for instance, you can display Ukraine, and it will break it into a regions. And if you will click on the region, then it will show all the cemeteries which are located in this region. Then you can apply a filter that will show in what condition cemeteries are located in that region. Same goes for all of the project countries. And I already prepared a separate tab where a 3D model is downloaded. So if you will click on a specific cemetery, then you will be able to see the data which we incorporated into the project website. If you will scroll down, well, you can see that there is pictures available on a slider. If you will scroll down, then you will be able to see that there is a separate tab, the one that I was talking about. And if you click on it, then it will start downloading. It will lead you to a separate page where the 3D model is available. I already have it here. It's already uploaded. It depends on the volume of the 3D model. So if the model is pretty big, it's pretty dense, then it will take more time to upload. So over here, you see that on the right side of the screen, you see the menu, which I described. Well, you can make all sorts of adjustments with it. But I think that most people are going to use the scroller density that will enable the model to be more dense. Yeah. If not many people see that there is an arrow here, but it's there. Yeah. So if you click on it, then this menu will disappear and the 3D model will appear. So, and you can rotate it. You can look at it. For instance, this one here, this is Vadul Rashkov in Moldova. I would like to also mention that due to the COVID restrictions, we did not start the surveys in time. And that's why there was troubles with the data flow. Yeah. And think that maybe like 70% of the data already uploaded to the project website. And it's still on its way. Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex.
Thank you, Samantha.
And now for our next speaker, who is not contributing pre-recorded remarks. We are very pleased to have her here live with us. Please join me in welcoming Ariella Wojcik, who is Director of European Affairs at the European Jewish Congress.
Thank you very much, Samantha. I hope you can all hear me. Dear esteemed colleagues, dear initiators and implementers of this wonderful initiative, on behalf of the European Jewish Congress, federating more than 40 Jewish community organizations across the continent and including almost all the targeted countries covered by this grant, I would like to congratulate you all on this extraordinary achievement that is at the heart of preserving European and Jewish heritage. Vice President Skinas reminded us of the important message that needs to be conveyed to future generations. We must preserve this heritage from the past, but most importantly, we must learn from the last physical witness of a Jewish presence contained in every town and village where Jewish communities were decimated in the Shoah. This is the material heritage of our Jewish communities, but it is also the material heritage of all European citizens, one that so often Jewish communities alone have been unable to preserve for the simple reason, as Phil Carmel said, that there are no longer Jews in these towns and villages. In fact, there is no greater rejection of Holocaust minimization and denial than the physical proof that once there were Jews in thousands of towns and villages in these areas, and today there are none. The reason began with intolerance and hate and led to the removal of Jews from our common European space in so many areas covered by this project. It is right and proper that education projects and involvement of local people in these projects are now utilized in their protection. I was very happy to hear about all these wonderful initiatives that Fabian presented, especially the beautiful film made about Kaunas, where my personal roots are. I would also like to echo the words of Phil Cormel and thank the European Commission for supporting and developing this project and creating a sustainable model to impact on preservation of these sites in the longer term. I would also like to thank Mr. Goerens and his colleagues in the European Parliament who gave their time, energy and support to launch this pilot project from its inception. Thank you also to the ESJF and your co-partners in Centropa and the Foundation of Jewish Heritage for implementing this project, which has been so needed for so many years. Our communities and affiliates have been looking for such a comprehensive project for a long time, and we are grateful that this material heritage is finally being collected and organized in such a systematic and professional manner using very impressive technology, as Alex just showed us. It was also a great privilege to listen to the personal account of Israel's Minister for Diaspora Affairs, Nachman Shai, who reflected on the importance to preserve this Jewish heritage and at the same time, all these personal family stories. As one of the great figures of Israel, the late Yigal Alon once said, when a people does not honor its past, it lives in a present of little substance and faces a future clouded in doubt. It is true for Israel, and it is true for Europe too. I and many of my colleagues remember very well when Phil told us back in 2015 of the setting up of the ESJF and its mission to preserve the Jewish cemeteries of Europe. How impressive that since its inception, over 200 sites have been physically protected. And now, with the help of the Commission and the consortium partners of this project, the extraordinary figure of 3,000 sites are preserved so that in all these places, the communities of our forebears will never be erased from the historical record. And as Katharina reminded us, desecration of cemeteries have increased during the pandemic. This protection is even more important in these worrying circumstances. We have learned today of 3,000 cemeteries. There are more to save and to record, more towns and cities and local authorities to be engaged, more teachers and students to be taught. It is our hope and the hope of all our communities that this is just the beginning, that the lessons learned from this project can lead to the comprehensive presence and collection of data from the remaining 3,000 sites not yet surveyed. It is clear that this is a pan-European mission and it requires the engagement of the European Union, the natural partner for any such enterprise. From our part, we pledge the continued support of the European Jewish Congress and all our communities in your efforts and congrats you again on a successful and historic project. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ariella, for your very important and strong words. Now for this next portion, I'm actually going to be presenting on our catalog of best practices for Jewish cemetery preservation, which was one of the required outputs of the grants and which we are very pleased to have in both digital and print form. So here is the actual book. And if you allow me to share my screen, I will show you the book itself. So this publication, like the rest, like all of ESJF's publication, is available on our project website and on the ESJF website. The project website once again is esjf-surveys.org. So the concept behind this catalog was to give an overview of cemetery preservation and protection initiatives in all of our project countries. And we decided for the purposes of this catalog to include also project countries from the previous year. So in addition to the seven that were mentioned, we also have Moldova and Greece presented here. We begin with a note from European Commission Vice President Margarita Skinas, who spoke just earlier, an introduction from our CEO, Philip Cormel. And then we go into the executive summary and methodology section, excuse me. I'll just briefly go over this here. The biggest challenge in compiling best practices for this catalog was really the vast multitude of initiatives to choose from and to narrow down. So in order to pick and choose our personal, or the ones that we felt were worthy of highlighting, we had to determine a set of criteria to guide our thinking. And that criteria is as follows. We begin with diversity, not only in terms of cultural and geographical diversity, but also the type of initiative described. I'll go into that in more detail in just a little bit, but essentially we broke it up into a number of categories: public sector, nonprofits and NGOs, academia, Jewish community initiatives, and so on. And yes, we try to showcase a range of public and private and grassroots initiatives. Transferability. This is something that is also very important for the European Commission. And the way that we define transferability is the likelihood or ability of a particular initiative to be carried out in another country. So in other words, we like to see projects that don't exist in a vacuum and that can be easily replicated in other countries regardless of cultural or geographical context. The third set of criteria was impact, measured how by how successfully an initiative was carried out and the response it generated. Four, sustainability. And the way that we determined this was by interviewing project leaders and also looking at all of their materials online and seeing which initiatives were continuously functioning versus those that were sort of one-off projects. And finally, we like to look at uniqueness. And what I mean by that is that, for example, if you look at something like cemetery cleanups, really we see tons of cemetery cleanups happening throughout all of our project countries. So how do you choose the ones that you want to recognize? We decided that the ones that were kind of worthy of highlighting, at least in this publication, were those that had an element beyond just the cleanup initiative itself, but were kind of rounded out with an educational component or other kinds of activities that gave it, made it more than just a volunteer project, but also an educational project with more dimension. So that's just a brief overview of the methodology. As you can see here, it goes into much more detail, but you can look on that in your own time. We also have a historical overview section written by our educational project officer, Shura Fischel, and the director of the Museum of Jews in Latvia, Mr. Ilya Lansky. And one thing I would like to mention before moving on, Michele Migliori, I know he's in the audience watching this right now. Special thanks to him. He is our best practices officer and also a writer at Jewish Heritage Europe. And thank you so much for your help putting this catalog together. It was truly a pleasure working with you. So thank you, Michele, for all of your knowledge contributions to this publication. So, selected best practices. I'll just briefly skim through these. You might recognize some of the names and projects featured here. We begin with individual / grassroots initiatives in all of our various project countries. Nonprofit and non-governmental organizations. And again, we tried to feature ones that were more recent and also continuous as much as possible. And here we have Greece from last year's pilot project. Government and public sector initiatives. Academic initiatives. Here we have ESJF's own technical manager, Alex Besarab, presenting one of our educational projects. Jewish community initiatives, of course, multinational initiatives. And what I mean by that, instead of a project taking place in just one country, this was kind of cross borders. Digital projects. And of course, each project or initiative that you see featured here has contact information, websites, email addresses, in case you're interested in learning more and getting in touch. It's all there. And now we have the voices from the community section, which is my personal favorite. This section, we wanted to give a voice to people in the communities, people on the ground. ESJF worked with a number of country coordinators in each of our project countries, who were very, very helpful in getting the word out and helping us to complete our work in these communities on the ground in the field. So we wanted to give them a voice and ask them to nominate who they felt was a great example of initiatives taking place in their countries. So in each country you see here, we have the country followed by the country coordinator who went ahead and interviewed each of the individuals that they nominated. And then you see their interview summaries here. And all the individuals themselves. I encourage you to take a look at this and, you know, read it in your leisure time, because there are some truly wonderful material here. And once again, I'm so thankful to each of our country coordinators for helping put this together. And then our last section here, Fabian spoke about this already, but essentially it's a summary of our educational projects that we conducted in partnership with Centropa. A summary of our process and results, followed by selected entries from the student competitions and a summary of some of the lesson plans that were submitted by teachers. Once again, all of this information is available on our website. If you're viewing the publication as a PDF, these titles are all hyperlinked. So you can watch the videos or visit the websites straight from here. And also, these are just kind of one featured entry from each country, but the project website has all of the entries and all of the winners, as well as all of the lesson plans in full in the various foreign languages that they were submitted in. And then we've finish up with a conclusion, what the consortium learned throughout the pilot project and in collecting these best practices. And finally, we finish up with an acknowledgement section of all of the people who helped put this together and some blurbs about the consortium partners. And there you have it. That is our best practices catalog. And before I wrap up, I want to also mention, this is not the only publication that we produced this year. Shuda Fischel, who's our educational project manager, was a project manager of translating our classroom guide into all of the languages of our project countries. So all of that information is available on our site. In the publication section of our website. Once this event is over, I will be sending out a video link and also links to all of our project materials to all of today's registered participants. So look out for an email from me tomorrow. And that is it for me. Thank you very much. And now I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Michael Mayle, who is CEO of our partners, the Foundation for Jewish Heritage, for some closing remarks. Michael?
Great, yes, hi there. You can hear me okay, Samantha?
Loud and clear.
Fantastic. We have heard today about very important and unprecedented Jewish cemetery preservation work and impressive on-the-ground programs highlighted by Fabian and featured by Samantha as she went through the best practices brochure. And I must say that what I found so striking when I'd gone through the brochure are the people leading these projects, local people with an energy and passion that is quite heroic. Clearly much is being achieved, and yet we also know in many ways we are just beginning. There is so much that could and should be done. The scale is simply enormous, but that also suggests the level of impact this work can have. There's something vast and profound out there right across Europe that we are helping to bring into focus. Hopefully this work will act as a call to action, which will be taken up by more and more people across Europe. The Foundation has been delighted to be a part of this very special work and to have established warm relations with our partners ESJF and Centropa. So let me end by again warmly thanking the European Commission for believing in this initiative and for backing it, thanking all our terrific speakers today, and congratulating everyone associated with this project on what has been achieved and the path that has been established that can take us forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Michael. Thank you for everyone in our audience who took time out of their day to join us today. If you showed up late, we did record the entire program and it will be posted on YouTube and social media in the coming days in its entirety. And once again, I'll send out a link to those video recordings to all of today's registered participants. Thank you again to all of our speakers, to the European Commission, to our partner Centropa and the Foundation for Jewish Heritage. This has been a tremendous endeavor and truly, I'm so pleased to be a part of it and to speak with you today. Thank you again. Take care. Signing off.